Okay, so now we come to post-college shows that I enjoy. Now, here's the problem is that I don't really get to watch a lot of TV shows nowadays. So this list is very limited. I'm sure there are tons of other shows that I personally would absolutely love that I haven't been able to follow. Not because I don't want to follow them, it's just I haven't had the time and I don't. There's still other shows that I'm currently still in the middle of watching, and I'm trying to finish those series. I don't want to start a new series until I finish those, because there's still like two series in particular that I'm still not even, one of which I'm not even in the middle of, and the other one I'm almost about to finish. But in case you're curious, these are the shows that I currently are my top 10 that I've watched or been following since college. Number 10 is How I Met Your Mother. I ha honestly haven't seen that many episodes of the show, but the ones that I've had have always been hilarious to me. The dialogue, whoever writes for How I Met Your Mother, I have always thought was really had just, it was just the perfect humor for me. The characters are great. I mean, I love Lily, who is played by, the same person who the same actor who played Willow in Buffy. Her husband, Marshall, is great, and of course there's Neil Patrick Harris. I mean, Neil Patrick Harris, great, 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 great actor. And Ted Mosby, I always thought Ted Mosby was really adorable and sweet. Like, of all the characters, Ted Mosby was the guy that I will like. If I ever met him in real life, I would totally date him. Totally want to date him. He just seemed like. He seemed like such an all-around nice guy, very genuine person, and funny and very attractive in his own way, very boy next dory like. So, I definitely would like to start watching How I Met Your Mother from the beginning. Apparently, they've gone through 9 seasons, so I've got a ways to go. But yeah, that takes the slot as my number 10. Favorite show post college number 9. Is Phineas and Ferb. This is a cartoon, a Disney cartoon, but, and I mean, I started watching it a couple of years ago just because it was on and it wasn't anything better to watch, and I was just really surprised at how, again, clever. I know I use that word a lot, but I'm sort of on a clever kick right now. How clever the humor is in that cartoon. There's a bunch of humor in there that adults can definitely appreciate. Now, I don't think the jokes ever get as racy as they did in the Animaniacs, but still, like, there's definitely been some parts of that show that I would watch, and I would just roll over laughing. And I'm always surprised because. I mean, I like Disney cartoons. I don't knock Disney cartoons at all. I of all people, definitely appreciate them. But I never thought that I would appreciate their humor this much. And of course, Perry the Platypus. Oh, love Perry. He's a guru. Love that side story. And Dr. Doofenshmirtz, whatever his, Dr. Doofenshmirtz, whatever his name is, Dr. the evil scientist. That hit again. Like the situations and the plot that they get into, especially when they start introducing Dr. Doofenshmirtz's daughter, and I can't give away too much, but like great, great series, great, great, great series. This one shouldn't come to a surprise to most people, but number 8 for my spot is The Walking Dead, and I mean, I started watching The Walking Dead before I played the video game. And I don't know why I enjoy this game so, why I enjoy this TV show so much, because it's so depressing. And yet I am hooked on the show, I'm hooked on the comic book series, and I'm hooked on the Telltale's game. I don't know, there's just something about it that just keeps bringing me back, and like I can't, I don't know, I'm just a glutton for punishment that way. But yeah, I mean, I think Rick definitely is a. Rick's not the only reason to watch the show because I'm big fan of Rick Grimes. Even though a lot of people kind of don't really like Rick right now because he's not really acting very smart, and I agree with that. There's a lot of things about Rick that doesn't seem to make sense given all the experiences that he's had. You'd think he'd know a little bit better. Daryl, oh geez, Daryl. Don't even get me started on Daryl. I actually absolutely despised Daryl in season one. Did not like him at all. I could not wait till he was killed off. But and then in season two, I started warming up to him a little bit, especially in the middle, because of actions that he started taking, which surprised me genuinely. And then something happened in season three. All of a sudden, we get to season three, and I'm like, oh my gosh, Daryl Dixon, bear my children. Have my children now. Like, I don't know. He just became such a really awesome character, which is interesting since I initially absolutely loathed him at the very beginning. So it's really cool to see how my opinion of people was able to change based on how his character, because that's the thing I loved about it, is that they evolved his character. They didn't, and I think that's what really helps a lot in many stories, is when you have a character that does evolve, especially for the better. I'm not a big fan when they devolve. When they evolve for the worse, that I'm not as interested, because I don't know, that's just not the kind of thing that entertains me or keeps me engaged. But seeing someone rise up from the ashes like that, the way that Daryl did, is and coming to his own, love that. Love that. I actually had thought about starting to do episode analysis, like episode reviews of shows like The Walking Dead. I just don't know how many people out of you out there would be actually interested in that, or how many people would be really all that up for watching it, but I don't know. If enough of you say that you think that would be interesting to know my thoughts on a specific episode, I'll consider it. Number 7 is Family Guy. I actually favor Family Guy more than The Simpsons. Again, the humor of Family Guy is not for everyone, but it's definitely humor that I've been appreciating. It definitely can be a little too much at times. Like, there's definitely parts where I'm watching it and I'm like, this isn't funny. Like, I don't find this funny at all. But then there are other parts where I just, you know, it's hit or miss. Family Guy is pretty much hit or miss. I think I definitely appreciated the earlier episodes more. I haven't really watched many of the recent episodes, so it's starting to jump the shark for me. I think it's starting to jump the shark for me a couple seasons ago. But it still makes it up there in my list of favorite shows after graduating. I'm not a huge South Park fan because South Park, I think, is too much for me. It's too racy. And yeah, like I can only take South Park in doses. There are specific episodes that I really appreciate because of the subject matter that they deal with. Like, I loved the World of Warcraft episode, because even though I didn't really play World of Warcraft, I know about World of Warcraft, and I knew enough about it to appreciate the episode. You know, I loved the Big Gay Al episode. I mean, that's a classic one from back then. Of course, I loved the Facebook one. The Facebook one I thought was hilarious. But for the most part, I'm not a big South Park fan, and I think Family Guy is like the right amount between South Park and Simpsons that makes it so that even though there are times where Family Guy makes some jokes which is too far off for me to appreciate, it still has, you know, hit moments, just like the miss moments that I, you know, particularly do favor. Most beloved show number 6 is Charmed. So I'm a big fan of paranormal, and there is a charm. I didn't do that on purpose. It just came into my head because I think it's genuinely correct for me, at least. There is a charm to this show, because I think the humor is very well written, is very well done. It doesn't always take itself seriously, and that's okay. The characters are, again, so well developed and so well written. I was not a huge Shannon Doherty fan at all to begin with, but I tried to give the show a chance anyway, even though I wasn't a big Shannon Doherty, but I loved her character. Like, Prue, her character, I just grew very attached, and I loved Piper, And I love Phoebe. I think Piper is my
Okay, which
favorite
one
of
of
the
you is the real
three.
pro?
More so when she
Step back.
was more so
I'm the
during the
rookie.
first two seasons, like before Piper became the leader. I think I like Leader Piper a little less, even though she's an awesome witch when she takes, becomes the lead of the three, of the power of three.
You Leo last night dish.
Well, it was nice. It was wonderful. We just had a few problems.
Problems? What problems?
Well, it's been a while since, I was a little nervous and I kind of kept freezing him.
Oh, Piper, you didn't.
I didn't mean to. First time.
Okay, so at what point in the process exactly did you freeze him? Hello. I gotta go.
I kind of miss the, that middle child dynamic between Piper and her other two sisters, between Prue and Phoebe. I kind of liked her being in the middle, and she was very sweet. She had a very sweet personality, more so than she does when she became a leader, which she kind of had to lose a little bit because, because you needed that authority, that sense of authority. But yeah, like Piper's great, and again, I still love Prue, I still love Phoebe, and then Paige came along, and this really surprised me because whenever a newcomer comes along, essentially to sort of replace another character without giving any, I don't want to give too much away, so apologize if I already did. But when another character comes along to replace another main character, there's always that danger of, well, the new person is never going to be as good as the original. And, it's really hard to, I guess, for you to accept as a viewer. It gets hard for you to accept someone new to coming in, especially if you love the character that that person replaced, and you're already attached to the other characters, the other main characters. But Paige, I was so surprised, was able to win me over so quickly. Like, I definitely liked her just as much. And she definitely came to her own. She wasn't a carbon copy of the previous character that she was meant to replace, but she was her own character and her own unique character, and she added a very unique dynamic to the sisters, which I absolutely was very impressed about. And it was that moment that I realized this is a show that I have a lot of respect for if they're able to do that with the characters and with the writing.
I lost my hearing during the biggest meeting of my life. I can't hear a thing. What? I can't hear you. What are you doing? You're a monkey. Yeah, okay. You're a monkey. Oh, you're an angry monkey. Oh, you're pissed. You're PMS monkey? No, of course not. Okay. Ball?
I'm so glad you're here. I can't see a thing, and I wrapped my car around a pole, and I know it sounds
Piper!
crazy, but I think it has something to do with that mangy monkey.
Piper!
Where are you? Who put that there? Oh my God, Piper, you're blind.
Yeah, Phoebe, I just said that. Now, can we talk about how a monkey could do that?
What did she say?
What did who say? The monkey? The monkey didn't say anything. He covered my eyes and stole my eyesight.
I think the monkey stole your eyesight when he covered your eyes.
Oh, Phoebe, are you listening to me? That's just what I said. You are acting like you can't even hear me.
Oh, Piper, it's no use. I can't even hear you.
We've got to find Paige. Why are you clapping?
And some of the story arcs I thought was very well done. I think that the Chris story arc was awesome. I'm not going to give away anything, but those of you who've seen the series, you know what I'm talking about. I love that story arc. So far, that's my favorite story arc of them all. In many ways, it's a roller coaster of emotions, huge roller coaster of emotions. And you think you have certain things figured out, but I think most people don't have things figured out until it actually is revealed to them in the series. But yeah, I again, Charmed is something that I'm still going through. I'm in middle of season six. So I'm almost through, or season seven. I think season 6 or season 7. I'm almost through everything, and I'm really excited to get through it because I might even start reading the comics, like the next season, after the last TV show season. The next show, number 5, shouldn't come to a surprise to many of you. It's Glee. Now again, I know a lot of people think that Glee has sort of been jumping the shark, which I understand, it's fine. I mean, I agree about that to some degree. But it still belongs as number 5 on my list because I just love the first season so much. First season was, I thought, the best. Second season I thought was okay. Third season I tended to like. I mean, certain parts of the third season I liked. Obviously, my favorite character in that show is Blaine. Not so much Kurt. Kurt I like just fine, but I'm definitely a Blaine fan. Darren Criss I think is awesome, and it doesn't hurt that he played Harry Potter in the Harry Potter musical, which again is awesome. For those of you who are Harry Potter fans, you need to see that. As well as the sequels, there's like two, they did Harry Potter musical and then a very Harry Potter sequel and then a third Harry Potter musical to complete the trilogy. Anyway, that, I don't want to get too far off the category of what we're talking about, but amazing series for you Harry Potter fans out there. But Blaine is, I love Blaine because I like it when TV shows and other media portray characters that don't always follow the stereotype. I mean, it's fine if they do, because, you know, some gay people do follow certain stereotypes. I certainly do. But they are far from, you know, the main representation of what gay people are like. Gay people are all different, and you know, there definitely are people that you might look at them and you wouldn't necessarily know, you couldn't tell that they were gay. And I kind of like that with Blaine. Okay, maybe the bow tie gives it away, but Blaine is one of those characters who I think, you know, he does break a lot of stereotypes. He adheres to certain stereotypes, but he also breaks a lot. And I think the more that gay characters in media break stereotypes, the better. Just because I think it makes more people realize and understand that gay people are all different. All gay people are different. Not all gay people are interested in Lady Gaga and Cher. Not all gay people like me, have hundreds and hundreds of shoes. Not all gay people are, you know, are into fashion and all that good stuff. It's very refreshing with characters like that. But yeah, I mean, I love Glee because I love music. I'm a big music theater person. I think anyone who's into music theater like shows like Glee or Smash. And it's just a fun show. It's not meant to be taken seriously. I mean, obviously there's tons of parts that are absolutely ridiculous, but it's okay. Like, you go into the show knowing it's not a totally serious show. You just kind of go in because it's just fun and it's just a lot of great music. My only gripe is I really wish that the people in the Glee Club would stop just jumping from one person to another relationship-wise. It feels like everybody's, you know, everybody's just kind of intermingling romantically. I'm like, I don't remember that happening as much in high school. Maybe apparently I didn't go to the right high school, but yeah. Favorite show number 4 is Heroes, based on season 1. Yeah. Season 1 was, for me at least, was probably the best season 1 set of episodes that I have seen in any show. Hands down, for me at least. There were so many episodes in that season that just knocked it out of the park, that I felt I was so engaged in. The characters were so diverse. It was just really cool. For those of you who don't know about Heroes, it's basically about these, all of these people around the world who, for some reason, start developing these special abilities, like superheroic abilities. And they all have individual stories. They don't all know each other, but every now and then, like, certain characters will end up running into each other, and then stuff happens, and then they separate, and then later on, another set of characters run into each other, stuff happens, and they separate. It's a really interesting way to tell a story. A lot of movies and other shows now have been following that concept, like Crash, I think, has done that, and other episodes have done that. But season one of Heroes did it so well, and I just, like, the characters, I just fell in love with the characters so quickly. You know, Peter Petrelli, obviously, my favorite. I think he's a lot of other people's favorites. Many of you can, you know, not only because he's good-looking, I love me some Milo, don't, I mean, I'll admit it, but, you know, he's just an all-around great character, like, great guy that I would love to meet in real life if he was actually real. Always than one, but, but yeah, Peter Petrelli, great character. I like Claire. A lot of people were really annoyed with Claire. I thought at least she was great in season one, at the very least. I liked her a lot. You know, and then of course Nathan Petrelli and Matt and Mohinder, again. Mohinder was great in episode one. Hero, again, great in season one. Like, I keep saying that, but because I do admit that Heroes kind of went downhill after season one, and a lot of the reason why that happened is because it's ironic why it happened, because the original design, Mr. Kring, when he originally came up with the concept of Heroes, was that it was supposed to be a revolving cast. Like, they would tell, there would be, characters would constantly come in and come out of the story, of the main storyline. So originally, they were going to start season two with mostly a completely new cast. Like, they would give the story arc of season one, and then most of the characters in season two would be completely new, and they would start another story arc. But because the series became so popular, and because characters of the show became popular, you know, people were gonna get upset, and I think they would have, if they didn't bring back, like, virtually the entire cast back, because they love those characters so much. And so they kind of changed things up from the original design and decided to continue season two with virtually all of the same characters, and I think that ended up hurting them, ironically, because it just... Part of the reason why season one, I think, was so engaging is because these people were discovering their powers, and they were growing into them and evolving with them, dealing with them, and there's a lot of really interesting, like, nuances that goes with that. But then when you go into season two, their powers have pretty much been established, and yes, some of them continue to grow and some of them continue to evolve, but it's just not the same. Like, that discovery, that initial discovery, it's just, you know, that we ended up liking from season one, it's just not the same. And so I think that's where it started to lose its charm a bit, and then they started going to, they started getting into contradict, like, doing things that contradicted something else that happened in another episode. Don't even get started about Siler, and all the flip-flopping that goes with Siler. Like, I love Zachary and Quinto, who I'm very proud of for coming out, but, yeah, there are a lot of things that was going wrong with Heroes. I heard that they're rebooting the series. I think they're trying to start Heroes back up again, which I'm excited for. I'm hoping that they take some of the lessons learned from the original run of Heroes and try to come up with something fresh that hopefully works better than the seasons after season one of Heroes. But we'll see. I don't know if they didn't promise that they were necessarily going to bring back any of the original cast, but they said that they were going to try to have specific characters from the original cast to make appearances, again, cameo appearances, which I think will be good enough, you know. But I think a fresh reboot, a fresh start would actually be good, because I think that Heroes had a really good potential. And any of you who are at least a bit curious about it, at least watch season one. I'm just telling you, just watch season one. I thoroughly, thoroughly would recommend it. And then when you're done with season one, you can stop. Like, unless you really, really are curious, you can move on to seasons, the following seasons. But at the very least, season one Heroes, for me, was so good that it earned for me the fourth place spot of my top 10 TV shows post-college. My third top TV show post-college is Modern Family. Again, clever writing, like, I can relate. I think all of us can relate with at least one or two characters in that show. It's about a family. You've got the father, Jay, who has remarried to this really saucy younger woman from Colombia, played by the lovely Miss Sofia Vergara, and her son, who's like an old soul, very wise, or at least extremely mature beyond his years, Manny. That's one household. And then you have Jay's son. Jay, by the way, is played by Ed O'Neill, Al Bundy, for those of you who don't know. His son, Mitchell, who I find really adorable, again, red hair, no surprise there. Mitchell, who happens to be gay, and his significant other, Cam, and their child, Lily, their Asian adopted child, Lily, and all of the shenanigans that happened there. So that's another household. And then you have the third household, which is Jay's daughter, Claire, who is super type A mom, and her husband, Phil Dunphy, who is a bit of a bumbling oaf, but he's, in my opinion, a very lovable, other people can disagree, but a lovable, bumbling oaf who tries to be the cool dad as much as possible. Very attuned to his feminine side as well, which I kind of love too. And then their three children. You've got Luke, who's my favorite. Not exactly the brightest crayon in the box, which is interesting because the actor who plays Luke is actually a certified genius, although he plays a character that's as dumb as bricks, which I find very amusing. You've got Alex, the middle child, who is the brains. She is the one that is super hard worker, who I actually relate with. I mean, I was Alex. I was definitely Alex when I was a kid. Always caring more about grades than anything else most of the time. And then Haley, who is kind of more of your typical teenage girl. You have those three different households. And, you know, the story jumps around between the houses. Normally they have their own special story arcs. What's really interesting is when you have characters from different households ending up joining together with other characters from the households and just watching the dynamic between those characters. Like, again, with all the talk that I've been saying about party members in video games and how I love watching the development between party members, it's essentially the same thing. Because each character is so unique and has a very distinct personality that when you put them with specific other characters, it's just really cool to watch them interact and to watch the dynamic between the two of them because, you know, it's like a science experiment, kind of. I just love it when they have an episode where you have two characters that are together who you normally don't see together. And just watching how things unfold between them. But the writing is really funny. And for anyone who values family, that anyone who values, who likes the feels, it always ends in a very feel-good. It all ends with a very feel-good message at the end, which, without it being too sappy, I don't think the show ever ends up becoming too sappy. I think it ends up being, you know, just enough so that it feels good, but without, you know, being too, like, oh my gosh, it's so sweet, I'm getting cavities. So, love that show. Favorite show number two is Doctor Who. I just recently started watching Doctor Who last year, and I just fell in love with it. I started with the reboot. I started with the Chris Eccleston Doctor Who. Really love the Chris Eccleston Doctor Who. I kept hearing more and more great things, awesome things about David Tennant. But I was like, you know what, I really like Chris Eccleston, and I will, you know, determine for myself what I think about David Tennant when it comes. Because Chris Eccleston, I thought, really gave a very interesting spin to the Doctor. Especially when I've been researching about how some of the Doctors before him behaved, which I really liked, and also the Doctors that came after him. I think that Chris Eccleston's Doctor was one of the more unique, and I really liked his take on him. And then comes David Tennant's Doctor Who, and I swear, within the first 2 minutes of watching David Tennant as the new Doctor after Chris Eccleston, I immediately fell in love with him. Immediately. Like, I knew right then and there, oh my gosh, I need to love this Doctor. David Tennant is the Doctor that I'm currently watching right now. I had just started the season after Martha, for those who know what I'm talking about. But I'm looking forward to meeting Matt Smith's Doctor. And then, of course, the next Doctor that's currently... I have a lot of catch-up to do, because I definitely am. I've been hearing so many things about all this hype over, you know, the Day of the Doctor, you know, the 50th year anniversary, I just can't wait. I just can't wait to get to it, because, again, such a fun show. Great show if you love sci-fi adventures, if you love time traveling. Like, traveling through space and time, I mean, that's... you gotta love that. And then... and just the humor, like, is so... it's kooky, but I love it. I love it. I love it, love it, love it. It's a guilty pleasure of mine. Never takes itself seriously. But even then, there's moments where it has a lot of heart to it. A lot of moments that gives you the feels, which I like. Doctor Who quickly became number two for me. And, of course, Captain Jack Harkness. I mean... come on now. And not only does he share the same name as I do, Captain Harkness, but his character is bisexual, and the actor that portrays him, John Barrowman, is completely gay. Yeah. John Barrowman is quite yummy, quite a lovely, yummy man. Very much so. And then last but not least, my top one post-college show for me is Buffy the Vampire Slayer. I mentioned this in my Q&A last year that Buffy was probably my favorite, I guess, protagonist in a TV series. And rightly so. So far, Buffy Vampire series has been my favorite series. It has been probably one of the more consistently... the series that I think has the most consistently good episodes for me. There are some Buffy episodes that I didn't particularly care for, but compared to other shows, I think, yeah, this was the series where most of the episodes that I have seen, I've loved. Again, clever writing, Joss Whedon is amazing. I really love, again, what he did with the universe, what he did with the characters. There are certain parts of it that I would have written differently, mostly with Oz, because I love Seth Green. Again, red hair, folks. You see the pattern here that I'm talking about? Loved Oz. Oz is hands down my favorite character of the entire series. Seth Green, I love that man so much. Oh man, I love that man. So funny, and in the TV show, his character Oz is so charming. And sweet in his own way, which I love. But yeah, the show I've seen the entire TV series and loved it from beginning to end. I was very skeptical watching the series. I didn't actually watch the series until 2 years after the final season of this TV show had ended, because I had seen the movie that it was based off of and didn't particularly care for it, even though it did have Luke Perry in it. That wasn't enough to really save the movie for me. But one of my coworkers, who I didn't think would have been remotely interested in Buffy, my manager actually convinced me to watch, like, he gave me the first season. And I just watched an episode after episode after episode and just and swallowed them whole and kept asking for more and just spent pretty much my entire Christmas break, you know, for 2 weeks, just nonstop. Like, it was a Buffy marathon, because I just devoured them all and just fell in love with the series. And now I am in the middle of reading the comics, season 8, and I heard they also released a season 9 in the comics. So, yeah. Buffy is number one for me and as far as favorite post shows of my life thus far, post-college shows. Okay, folks, I've been talking way too long now, so That marks the end of my Q&A session for 2014. So thank you very much for all of you, especially if you've somehow managed to sit through the whole thing. I appreciate you guys, your patronage, and for watching however many videos you end up watching of mine. Hopefully that you found some of the things that I talked about interesting, especially for those of you who also have watched the shows that I have watched or are also looking forward to the games that I brought up. So thank you guys for watching. I'm tired. I need to get to bed. And I guess I will talk to you guys later. So until next time, folks, love yourselves. Love each other.